Is it what crazy? Or tall crazy? Or what type of crazy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, child looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our military to discipline. I said, oh, hell
on Cold Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
Welcome back, and you run to Core TV News Lagos. The program is Core Digest, and our topic today, the kidnapping rage, a generational issue. I want to begin with the lawyer. What started as agitation, a tool for protest, and to, you know, bring to the fore the issues of environmental degradation, exploitation, and the rest, has become a tool for some people's businesses and investments, a tool to kill, a tool to score political goals. You know, where did we go wrong here?
Well, let me start by saying that you see, there's the scientific study of law by Calgary says that there are five ideas that are the roots of human conduct. You have law, you have morals, you have religion, you have equity, you have social convention. And then when there's a breakdown in these core values, I'm using the name of your television. When there's a breakdown in core values, you get the consequence. The German philosopher Hegel says that in every state of things, there's a contradiction which the conflict of the opposite must resolve. So the kind of thing we are getting in our society today as an implosion of a Leviathan society where everybody's unto himself and God is for us all. It's a consequence of a lot of things that have happened in our national history. When you tell a young man, you say that he's the leader of tomorrow. Those of us who left the universities in the early 80s, we know that we are not leaders of tomorrow either.
We are not leaders of today.
And so when you keep giving people that sense of illusion, and like I had occasion to discuss with some people when I was coming here this morning, that a Nigerian judge will retire at the age of 70. A Nigerian professor will retire at the age of 70. Now, when we begin to have a president that wants to contest election at the age of 72, then let's consider what the other age will be thinking about. The better part of those who were nationalist leaders in Nigeria, whether we want to say that we want to justify the Nzogoku or not, were in their 30s. When they were doing that. So, and if you look at the young man and, you know, moving to what they refer to the international child right,
yeah,
talks about the definition of who is a child, who's an adult, and then you get who's a teenager. It's at the age of when you are in your teenage that you begin to experiment. But the age of actuality actually starts from, you know, age of 20 to 30 to 35. The American society expects that when you are 35, you ought to have had a car, you ought to have had a job,
right?
That is how the system has been programmed. And there was a time that there was a big battle between President Obasanjo and former President Ibrahim Babangida when Babangida was 70. And Babangida was saying that, when I was in government, this was what happened. And it was at 70, and I was on television, they were asking me, what do I have to say to that? And I said, divide 70 by 2, you get 35. That was the age Martin Luther King won the Nobel Peace Prize in America. For a country like ours, that is just the size of Texas, all right? For somebody in America at the age of 35 winning the Nobel, meaning that almost on a continent, he had been able to impact for not less than 10 years. That's about 25 years earlier than that time. So we found ourselves creating the kind of violent implosion. A professor asked me what I wanted to write on, you know, for a PhD thesis. That's Professor Theo Vincent. I said, I wanted to write some violent implosion in African-American literature. Because when the title of James Baldwin's title, when the title of his novel is Nobody Knows My Name,
yeah,
Raphael Lessing says Invisible Man, you drive them underground. Mm. And so when you drive them underground, you are going to get implosion from that.
Absolutely.
So the society is ripping from the implosion it has bottled up over time. So I'm sure when we begin to discuss generational thing, we get into that.
Right? Yes, Ismail,
yeah.
This is the implosion he's talking about now that has set kidnapping, you know, as a rage in the Nigerian society, seems to temper poverty, you know, corruption, grievances, whether political, environmental, or what have you, and greed.
I also want us to consider the gradual breakdown of morality, where society considers this get-rich-quick syndrome as being smart. And some persons who have unlawful access to arms take advantage of this and do what they want to do with it. How did we get here? Politicians, leaders of thought, some influential persons in society feel that the only way to always have access to what they want to do is to get some persons armed. You saw the recent Bayelsa election. The people wielding arms in these places are people who can metamorphose from being political thugs to kidnappers. Because whoever must have harmed them may never have considered disarming them after the operation for which they were harmed. Sometimes I find it hard comparing the Nigerian situation with other crimes because we have our own peculiar challenges. So not until we address it from the root causes, we may be going nowhere.
Well, Magneza,
yes, sir.
In addressing it from the root causes, it's like a people, a generation that has lost hope, as Soyinka called it then, over three decades ago, that his generation is a lost
wasted generation,
and they've turned everything into ashes in his mouth or in their mouths. Isn't that the same situation? Such postulations three decades ago still holding sway?
I would rather say that Soyinka was being apocalyptic. You know, was being apocalyptic, was just telling us what was going to happen. If you go and read his book, You Must Set Forth Dawn.
Yeah.
I see the scenario that happened when Olarotimi, the author of The Gods Are Not To Play, was driving from Lagos to Ife. And when he got to Ikorodu, old Ikorodu Road, he ran into a military roadblock. And he had his expatriate wife beside him. And the military guys asked him to come down. And while the guy was not trying to cooperate, they told him to lie down on the bonnet and they were going to flog him. Soyinka says in You Must Set Forth Dawn that anytime he remembers that scenario, he thought that would have been the day he would have died because he wouldn't have lied down for them. And so, you see, gradually, like he said, issue of national morality. Today we saw on the pages of newspapers, people who were footballers are being compensated with millions of naira.
31 years after.
All right, we have a lot of misplaced values. It no longer matters if an individual is very brilliant. The days that our father in the law, Pastor, you know, Kadijari Adeboye, was the first person I interviewed in my career as a journalist. And he was telling me a story of how he had applied.
Been lucky as a rookie.
Yes.
You had that was such
my,
a
that was
big...
My, that was my first
such interview. A big fish.
Yes, that was my interview. As a matter of fact, when I filed in the report in 1986, October, they didn't use the story in Prime People until March 1987 because he was not going to make a cover. Now, what I'm saying is that while he was sharing the experience with me, he told me that he actually wanted to go and study history. But because his parents didn't have enough money, and there was no scholarship for history, there was only scholarship for mathematics. That was why he applied to the University of Nigeria and Sukkah to study mathematics. And 2 years after he got there, the civil war broke, so he had to transfer to Ife to complete it. Now, what I'm saying is that in this day and age, there are brilliant, 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 highly brilliant children out there that are aspiring to acquire knowledge, to contribute to knowledge. People who are old are actually, some of them feel that, I have some contribution to make to knowledge. Some people are back in the university even with their old age because I feel that there's something, there's a missing link. And when the society doesn't compensate that, and it compensates something else, all right? At a time in this country, you have military officers who manage to pass their PSC, pass staff college, you know, becoming head of state and president and have to appoint professors as ministers. You know, that we got to that level. And so when at a point in time when values began to be degraded, it percolates down the whole realms of our national life. And that's why we are here. That's why in those days when children see their headmaster coming, they take to their heels. But at a point in time now, if you're a lecturer in the university, they call you by your name anyway, and you know, things like that. So at a point in time in this society, and I remember I was doing a story in Nigerian Born Again Professor, and I had to speak with Professor Olumuyiwa Awe, husband to Bolanle Awe, Professor of Ionospheric Physics, Emeritus Professor. And the man told me that almost everybody who had a second class upper and first class from the University of Badajoz in physics never came back to do postgraduate studies. They would rather go and do accounting, ICANN, and go into the banking sector. So at a point in time, Nigeria began to derail in values. And so the core values is that he adulterated. So we really cannot lay claim to any core values right now and say that this is what we are holding a lot for people to imitate. And that's when the children don't say anything, they become flounders.
Yeah, but it is really surprising that the people that we looked up to, you know, decades ago as growing kids, as, you know, everybody, you know, around the neighborhood is a guardian, is a father. You don't, any misdemeanor, they don't wait for your parents to come before, you know, you are served the necessary punishment as adequate as, you know, the offense you've committed. What, besides morality, is it avarice? Is it that even those we looked up to then, they are not giving us, showing us good examples? Take, for example, barrister we had earlier mentioned, even in the papers, somebody like Chief Olufalaye, who is saying that he's going to open up over the arms deal scandal and things like that. He was a victim of kidnapping.
Well, you see, the state we found ourselves is very unfortunate. Kidnapping is one thing that I wouldn't want to say it has come to stay, because that would be sounding very pessimistic. But just as we have armed robbery, arson, other kind of crimes all over, kidnapping will always rear its head whenever the opportunity comes to those who have tendencies to perpetrate it. You can't water down the issue of morality, and you cannot divorce our drive or our unnecessary respect for wealth, irrespective of how it was acquired, from these issues. Everybody wants to make it very fast, very fast. Almost every youth you see is on the fast lane. And no, if you try to tell them to please take it easy, it's one step before the other. It's like you are not in line. They are not listening again. And if you see the tools with which our youths operate now, different from what they had or their age mates had some 30, 40 years ago. We are now in the e-age. The internet is contributing to all the challenges we're having now. It has its own sour side, and we must live with it. Communication implosion is also part of it. Just as the police is applying technology, those committing these crimes are taking steps to beat the system. So we must always up our game. You can't divorce morality. You can't separate our reverence for wealth, not minding where or how it came, from the challenge we have now. Not until we go back to having a proper moral standard, we cannot build a better society standing on a weak moral fiber.
Not surprising. Not with all the churches and the mosque in all nook and cranny of. I mean, go through any typical street and you cannot. I mean, you won't have no less than half a dozen. That is, if that street is just maybe about 20, 30 meters, churches there. So, what is going on? Generational gap or. The instructions are not just getting into one ear and going out in another.
Well, I was actually going to, you know, initially I tried to identify the five ideas that are the roots
absolutely,
of human conduct.
Yeah.
As law, as morals, as religion, as equity and social convention. Where you mentioned that when a child is given back to in a society, he or she is to be mentored in a communal environment by other parents, other than her biological parents. All right, and that's why the Yoruba people will say agbakinwa loja kuri omo tuntun. When a woman is bearing a baby behind her back and it's in the market and the baby is not sitting well behind the woman, somebody else will come there and say, no, woman, could you please do this thing properly? And she is undergoing training right there.
Absolutely.
All right, so at a point in time in our society, I was speaking with Professor Fatoba of blessed memory now, that why do you wear your hairstyle the way you were wearing it? The whole place bald upstairs and the beards are bushy. It's because he said it's a symbolic representation of how the world has turned upside down. Now, the Victorian essayist, Matthew Arnold, in The Function of Criticism at Present Time, he said there are two realms of human existence where you can have quackery and charlatanism, and that is in the area of politics and religion. Soyinka had already told us about that, and that's why when they were asking me that, my state was going to propose for me to go to the national conference, I said I was going there to go and propose cultural revolution, a situation in which I'm not going to suppress other people's cultures. Nigeria has about 250 languages, and there's an institute in Jordan that is responsible to translating, English Bible into different languages in Nigeria. And then, if you can get the transfer of Brother Jerry, the Jerry place, translated to all of us, so that when you sit down in the church and you are looking at a pastor, you know that this is Brother Jero. Either I'm a Chume or I'm a Mokwe or whatever, a victim of charlatanism. And so people, issue of licensing, and then when we get to Corporate Affairs Commission to register churches, the question is that if I want to register a communication outfit, it will require that I have a certificate showing that I'm a trained journalist, or whatever, before I could be registered. To register my firm, but there is nothing by which you can register an individual that is a pastor. You understand what I'm saying?
No, it's we were brought up
in an Orthodox environment in which people who were the first woman to teach me in primary one was Mrs. Olufosoye, the wife of former prelate of Nigerian Anglican Communion.
Yeah.
And so before you could become a provost in Ondo, St. Stephen's Cathedral in Ondo, you could have had your degrees.
Mm.
All right, you have been taught in theology, in pedagogy, and so but now it's every commerce, everybody comes there and it's a pastor. And the value, some people send some messages to you and that, if a lawyer, if a medical doctor is attending to a patient, you find out that by the time the patient gets out of the sick bed, he's going to give more money to the pastor than he's giving to the medical doctor, to the surgeon.
Yes.
And so these are
a miracle.
Yes, so these are areas of our national life where we have missed it. So when we begin to have children, politicians will go to the university campuses and organize them into clubs and whatever and use them as foot soldiers. They are going to backfire. So those guys, there was a guy who gave me a ride at the time from to Ikorodu, and the guy told me, I was doing some runs. And by the time he began to tell me about runs, which was not in my vocabulary, generation.
You asked him to drop it.
I was better tutored about their generation, about what is alive to them. And when you listen to the accounts of people who had been in incarceration as a result of kidnapping, which, the last review
at the University of Lagos. You understand what I'm saying?
We had read about prison notes, maybe demand died, the shuttle in the crypt. You have read about, procession, hanging day in poetry as we were preparing. Those of us who were going to university at that time, we were win on some literatures. Zambia shall be free by Kenneth Kaunda. People go by Albert Lutuli. And so those are the things we were prepared. The syllabus shows it from the very beginning that when you get to the university, for you to get admission to that university, you have to master this. So we need some literatures, we need some writing, we need some intellectual reawakening.
Who is reading again today? The reading culture.
This is the consequence of our national life, because as a matter of fact, when you read, a driver was coming, my sister sent the driver to come and pick my property from one place to the other, and said, okay, but I need you, there's nothing to pick in brother's house other than books now.
Now, before I come to you, Ishmael, let me give you a quick statistical data of where kidnapping has placed Nigeria in the global level. So statistics show that the level of kidnapping activities in the country is not encouraging at all, because many citizens in the country seem to be engaging in it. It's gradually becoming a big business, something that is holistic. From what the lawyer said, a total breakdown of the fabrics of culture, religion, even politics, And Nigeria is said to account for 26% of kidnap and ransom incidents globally. That's in the first half of 2013. And a recent statistics released again by a CSO, NYA International, Specialist Crisis Prevention and Response Consultancy, indicates, in the data on the kidnapping incidents released by RiskMap report in 2014 and subtitled Global Kidnapping Hotspots, Nigeria is seen as the fifth among the countries that have experienced high kidnapping incident in that year. Ishmael, the values have fallen. And it's like the youths have turned their back against morality, which both of you have said. But, you know, this ember is being fanned again by even some older people who profit from it.
Very unfortunate, the Nigerian state tolerates kidnapping. I'll give you an example. Sometimes last year, the then president of Nigeria was to go commission something somewhere in the South. Some 10 or 9 journalists had to go as advance party to do an overview.
In Baramatu?
I don't know.
I know, but I'm telling you, I'm a journalist, so I'll tell you. And I know Magnus.
And these journalists were kidnapped.
Mm.
And they were kept somewhere for some days. And there were threats that the president of Nigeria shouldn't come for the commissioning. Not only did the president withdraw from the commissioning, on release of
the 9 journalists,
nobody was invited to write a statement. The police did not investigate and nothing was done. I see this as state tolerance to a very heinous crime. Because I expect the Nigerian state, or the government then, that has been dead openly, to rise up to the occasion. But quite unfortunate, as we speak, nothing was done. Even when the journalists tried to give the security agencies clue as to who masterminded their kidnap and the interactions they had with their abductors, nobody seems to be interested. That's the Nigerian government. So if you ask me, to a very large extent, the Nigerian government itself has treated it with kid gloves, or sometimes appeared to tolerate it and encourage it, because whoever must have done that may still want to do a repeat. So we are in a fix until we decide to treat it as a crime and treat every perpetrator as somebody that must be brought to book to pay for their evil deeds. We will continue revolving around a cycle and we'll go nowhere.
Magnesa, as a lawyer journalist, do you see a state complicity in, you know, the incidents of rising kidnap situation, or is it just a kind of helplessness in the hands of the state? Because we had seen situations where kidnap victims have been rescued alive together with their kidnappers arrested and are being tried now.
Yes, when we talk about states, the idea of state itself is pre-classical. You know, it dates back to Plato. When Plato says that it's either the philosopher becomes a king or the king becomes a philosopher.
Yeah.
And then the idea of state is that powers are concentrated in a body. But a situation in which powers that are supposed to be concentrated in a body, the body itself has collapsed. So what I'm saying here, without sounding too pessimistic or too critical or cynical, is that when you're talking about the state, who is the state? If you say that journalists have been kidnapped and there hasn't been investigation into that, do you know the source of the people, the criminals themselves, who had given them, you know, who are they? Because you find out that there was a bank robbery in Ikorodu not too long ago. And if you read through it as if you are reading James Hanley Chase and you are studying literature, and you know that, oh, at certain point, it's not possible within the possibility of time for these criminals to have this detailed information about this banking institution without an insider. So the question is that, in whose hands are we really at? You know, are we really in the hands of the security people that themselves are part of the society, they are phenomenal product of the society? Because a good number, like I was in 1997, when I had the closest shift with death in my life, I went to visit a friend of mine who was a commissioner in Kogi State. And Afakiya, who was the governor of the state at that time, had sent the commissioner to go and launch a garri processing unit in a village. And we ran into robbers. And I'm sure by the time we found out that all the 3 cars we were in were perforated with bullets, you know, when we got to Army Records, when you get to Lokoja, off Abuja Road, on your way to Lokoja, the Army barracks there. And they told us to come out of the vehicle, and you need to see that the quantum, the quality, the sophistication of the bullets couldn't have been gotten on the street. All right? The thing must have been procured. So there's a whole gamut of, and then you find out that most of those states that we are talking about that are crime-free today, or they are minimally crime-free today, they had philosophers as their progenitors. All right. If you are talking about the communist country like China, like Korea, like whatever today, you have the origin of the dialectics of materialism originated from Karl Marx, Nikolai Lenin, Mao Zedong, those who contributed to what the country will be like. We had had them in the past in Nigeria. We had Voice of Reason, Voice of Courage, Voice of Wisdom, written by Obafemi Awolowo, Autobiography, whatever, these are the books of history, my Odyssey by Nnamdi Azikiwe, and stuff like that. Time was when the university curriculum, the school curriculum made it important. Imperative for you to imbibe that. An individual gets out of the university today, plus or minus, you ask him, somebody came to give me a course. I said, I want to supervise. I asked him, I said, who supervised your project? He said, so person. And I found out that the supervisor probably used one of his testers, whatever. A lot of compromises. Whereas in our time, I can point out, I told my student, look, when I teach you here, the woman who supervised my project is a professor in University of Missouri, Kansas City. I can refer to her. She's there as a model, but a society where those things are no longer important. So, and they are the product that you produce, you get into the military, that you get into the Nigerian police, they get to everywhere. You don't have to know anything as long as you can get money. All right, the society itself doesn't appreciate you. If you speak too much English, they say, I contested the election in 2007 to go into the National Assembly where Femi Gbajabiamila won the election. And a student of mine brought into the political party, I contested under a court party. And when I got to Surulere, my constituency, the same constituency where Governor Fashola came from. And you get there, you begin to tell them about ideas. You say, oh, God, please, Professor, when you book our affair, we want to drink beer, we want to smoke him. You want to give us money. So the society has gotten to that level, and those ones are products of the society, parental irresponsibility, fathers, who don't care what happens to their children. The moment they can impregnate a woman, they answer to being a father. The moment they can carry pregnancy, they answer to being a mother. So I think that it's a whole lot of problem. Before we begin to define what is a state?
Well, a huge problem it is, the issue of the generational gap and not imbibing, those morals, those things, cultural norms that held us together then. And you mentioned the superhighway now, the internet as a superhighway. Time was when, like Magnesia said, we would even study the books and were taken on guided cinema tours to go and see in practical terms and the rest. I don't think they do all this again. Rather, what they probably do with the explosion of the internet is to watch, they want to watch some of
pornography.
Yeah, these films on how to kidnap and the rest, or insurrection, raise insurrection against state.
Well, I see.
Is the media got anything to play in this?
Very well. ICT has foisted on us its own unfair share of hardship. Because when we embrace the very many good aspects of it, criminals in their own hard thinking devise ways to abuse it. Ozekome, in explaining his ordeal, said they told him while in captivity that when they want to make calls, they don't make calls from the venue, from the location where he was held captive, because they already know that the nearest base station of the network service provider
will pick them and give them
away. They will travel far. They explained to him that he shouldn't get happy or excited that anybody will locate
where
he was being kept, that they will travel very far to initiate the calls. So you can see where technology has aided crime. I don't know if the ongoing SIM card registration is going to address this. Few days back, I received text messages from normal 419ers indicating some lines with which you can call for a job, which I never applied for. I also received another from another phone telling me I won, blah, blah, blah. It keeps coming. And I wonder if these lines were actually registered. So the media is not completely insulated from the kidnapping industry. Let me use that word. It's a gang, it's a cartel, it's even a chain. Enlightened people were part of it. We even got to hear that they have doctors working with them. It's that bad. So if somebody had gone through the university system, spent 7 years to qualify as a medical doctor,
is to be a doctor to criminals
and consult for criminals,
then what would you say of the lawyer? The lawyer is a lawyer to anybody.
Ozekwuma said when he was shivering and feeling sick, a lawyer came.
A doctor came.
And when you hear that, you now have reasons to worry that so these people could go and get a doctor recruited into the chain. That is why their bills can be higher for ransom, because so many persons must be paid.
We were together at the University of Lagos a couple of days ago when Professor Hope Igaga, you know, recounted his ordeal titled Your Hour of Death is 10 o'clock. And although he refused to mention the amount of ransom paid, but money was paid. And when asked, it glossed it over. What would you think?
I would rather think that we should be more radical in our analysis, i.e. that beyond the issue of payment of ransom, it's consequential, it's sequential. You know, once there's a cost, there's going to be an effect in philosophy. And so when you have issues like that, the consequence is that people are after there to grab money. But I think that we should be interested in that work itself. You know, the PhD thesis I'm putting together is, it's a PhD thesis I'm writing on literature and medicine. What is the interface between literature and medicine? If a medical doctor, I would feel that, you know, before now, it had never been a requirement for you to have a credit in literature for you to read medicine. I think it's important. Because a medical doctor that had gone through a training, science is about premise and conclusion, as Matthew Arnold would say.
Absolutely.
But humanities is about persuasion. And so, and that's why Arnold says that in literature and science, he says people would rather carry arms for dogma, for persuasion,
yeah,
than premise and conclusion. If you say 2 + 2 is equal to 4,
I don't need to carry arms.
You don't have to, all right? But when you are persuaded that look, when you get out of here, you are going to see.
It becomes an opium.
All right, and so, yeah, it's an opium. And that's what religion has become in our society, and it has gone into politics also.
Yeah.
All right, so to the extent that we have lost all those areas, internet services, in those days, if you go and procure a laptop produced in America today, it's going to tell you the history of Benjamin Franklin without you putting anything in there. Those are the softwares that came with the computers. Because they feel that for you to be a student, you don't need to know how the thunder catcher was invented, who donated the Statue of Liberty to which country, and stuff like that. So then issue of education itself and curriculum development and issue of whether formal education has actually, they talk about education, standard of education has fallen, is debatable because it depends on what you want to do with it.
Yeah.
All right? Like somebody was trying to, at the time we're having, rapport on that book, somebody asked whether if you are violent to a child and whether the child will become violent or whatever. But if you are talking about stoicism today, that is indifferent to pain and pleasure. My mother taught me, in discipline, she will be flogging you and be telling you, I don't want to hear the sound of your cry. So as you are taking the pain, you are supposed to be swallowing the pain. So these are issues that we no longer find around. And a lot of irresponsible parents, she's a mother, she's this and that in the neighborhood, she can buy houses and whatever, and she can build houses, irrespective of morals. But you have a country that had philosophers as founding fathers making it impossible for you to have more than a child. And when you have more than a child, you have to pay tax to government for having more than a child. And not going to school becomes a crime in that society. And so when you talk about issue of criminology, tendency for people to want to commit crime, and then you look at the teachers themselves. I know when I was in law school, you find students who aspirants to the bar, stealing pants and bra, smoking them, aspirants to the bar, all right? And so when you find out that in the Council of Legal Education itself, the curriculum of the school, how is it tailored towards making sure we produce responsible lawyers? The teachers are doing their best, very brilliant people, you understand, in their own generation. But the kind of generation that is coming to law school, for instance, what are they? The rules of professional conduct is there for you to guide your conduct. And by virtue of the case in Rose and Worsley, you are supposed to, a lawyer is like a taxi cab, you know, you can carry anybody. By your training, you are supposed to carry anybody. So it's not as if somebody, when some people say that you are not supposed to take some high profile cases in crime, no, it's not like that. That's why Jesus Christ himself was called an advocate, because he was supposed to be advocating for sinners.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we are now talking about core values in our society with respect to making sure the media itself, you know, it's like a tabula rasa, whatever you write on it,
yeah,
you know, is what you get.
All right, gentlemen, would take another break, and Ismail Anyemo will be excusing us. By the time we're returning, we're most going to be having our other guest, Bola Oba, who is a public affairs analyst. I will take a short break now, and stay with us.
For topical issues, Nigerians must have something to say.
Arms, we don't need arms for anything. Let them put it into education.
They need to buy another arms now.
What are they fighting for?
What? Who?
Ebogara!
Government should deal with them squarely.
Please help us bring back our guests.
No money, no markets. We are dying. Everybody is crying. Nothing, nothing.
Any man God support, no man stops.
It's a prophecy I believe he must have received from heaven. Yes!
The people giving voice to the voiceless.
You can now watch Core TV News live from anywhere in the world on our website, www.coretvnews.com. Click on Live TV on our website and watch us live.
And welcome to Core TV Primetime News.
To follow us on Twitter, click on Twitter icon on our website. And Facebook, click on the Facebook. And YouTube to see all our previous news production. You can also watch us live on YouTube. Click Core TV, leave a space, then news. Core TV News, a 24-hour news station.
I want to be a doctor and help people when they are sick.
I want better education and training so I can be a soldier and protect my country.
I want better roads to avoid accidents so I can get to school on time safely.
What type of crazy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, driving looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our ministry to disrepute. I said to hell
on Core Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
You're still on to Core TV News Lagos, and the program is our flagship breakfast program, Core Digest. Our topic still remains the kidnapping range, a generational issue. And I've now been joined by Bola Oba, who is not only a public affairs analyst, he's an entrepreneur. Bola, with your bulky frame, you know, one would be saying that you'd be a really good you know, a commodity for kidnap and the ransom.
If you are doing a comedy, then we contact.
I'm not a comedian here. I let the measure, the size, and the rest. And,
if you think it's comical, a Malay that has stigmatized our nation globally, a Malay that is now making investors run away from our nation, a Malay that is making us live in a state of paranoia. It's comical after all, and in Parawa, any no lama, who better Kafirani than for us to have that attack with it.
Translate that, you know, for our teaming viewers.
I'm saying it may even be reasonable, as you've decided to do, to be comical about it, be humorous about it, because at the end of the day, you know, we cannot live in a state of perpetual paranoia.
But that's the situation we've been put in now, because it's been identified that kidnapping is a big, big ring. It's a big, big business. It's not just, you know, a job for the plebeians. You know, it's a job for the rich now because of the sophistication that goes along with it.
There is no sophistication to it. It's just a failure of governance. And
there's no sophistication in kidnapping?
There is no sophistication to it. It's just a total failure of governance at all levels of our society and the concomitant effect of anomie that pervades our society. It's simple. Look, we were told when I was growing up, we overemphasized academic education. People went about acquiring certificates, became useless to themselves and useless to society, couldn't be employed. And to be honest with you, when you have youngsters who ordinarily are in a state of anomy, they want to re-engineer society not by doing it in a way a purposeful and visionary leadership will lead them. They will cut at any tree, even if cutting that tree would affect the general thing. That is one. Two, when I was growing up, we used to look at some professions as professions of honor. You know, professions of honor. Now, you could be a medical doctor in this country and still be earning wages below reasonable living wages. And yet, let's now take it home. And yet, we have people operating in law enforcement agencies and they are paid peanuts. These people, with the body of knowledge they have, with the equipment and tools of work that they operate with, most of them, and I'm sorry to say this, and I've had senior police officers told me this before, I was having lunch one day with one of the recently retired Inspector General of Police. Indeed, he was then the Commissioner of Police, Lagos State. It was just about the time I was moving back. I was coming back from Europe to resettle back home. And he was telling me that majority of the robberies, sophisticated robberies in banks, are conducted by either soldiers, you know, the lower rank of the armed services, or MOPO. He says whenever they get to a robbery scene, just cursorily looking at the robbery scene, they could know whether it was, so, you know, members of the armed services or some of their boys, MOPO. He told me that if I was looking to rent a house, I should not rent a house near a military barrack, a military cantonment, because sometimes the lower rankers and the children of officers, sometimes when they're broke, they operate in some of the neighborhoods. He told me not to get a house near a tertiary educational institution campus, because some of the courts in the school, when they are broke, they strike in their neighborhood. He told me, you see, We are in a state of anomaly as a result of the failure of governance. And when such a scenario prevails, you want me to shock you? I can go into the street to tell Nigerians that what is happening in Nigeria is not peculiar to us. Today, if you are mentioning some of the most celebrated, some of the most organized, some of the most orderly societies on the face of the earth, you'll be mentioning a country like Germany. But if I should tell an average Nigerian watching this program what prevailed in Germany after the end of the Second World War, from 1945 to 1951, they would never believe it's the same Germany we're talking about, when women were prostituting themselves just to get a stick of cigarette from an American army. Look, our leaders have failed us. And because our leaders have failed us across the district, and when I say our leaders, I'm not only talking about those who are in political leadership, or even our parents between the 70s and the 80s, unbeknownst to them, were failing us, and they didn't know they were failing us. Like some of us are failing our children now. They over-accentuated academic education. Most of us accumulated certificates, and we ain't getting. We are not solution providers, and certificates don't solve problems. People solve problems, and only people who have marketable skill sets solve problems. We are still doing the same thing. We would rather bribe teachers to make sure that our children pass their WASC. We would rather bribe registrars and admission officers to make sure that our children get some schools to go to just to acquire certificates, not to be useful to themselves and society. Ah, cheering, Keke.
Magnesia, it's quite. Morale dampening, the kind of scenarios he's painted and the rest. How can we then be talking about solution? Can these anomalies, be reversed?
Yeah, I think that we have
to... I ask this question against the backdrop of our earlier discussion about the kind of education that we're getting, even the people running the school, which he mentioned about the kind of education. But who are the people behind some of these schools? After the privatization of education, whether we like it or not, that's what has happened in Nigeria.
Well, he said a number of very salient points, made mention of very salient points, i.e. issue of mystifying certificates, credentials, for its own sake. But you see, when you read two essays, one was written by Henry John Cardinal Newman, The Idea of a University, and the other one was written by Albert J. Nock, The Disadvantages of Being Educated. Each of those essays tells us about the fact that education is different from training. Training is what you can do. Education is what you can become. When we talk about education, the kind of education that the colonial world, or we inherited from the world, whether you are colonial or anti-colonial or imperial, is that when there is a thinking process, when people are able to think, all right? The people who came in here, in America, people still go to Americans still see that if it's a very brilliant student, they want to grant him scholarship. And that's why in America, the student loan you get, you can keep paying until that kingdom comes. Because they feel that you have to be educated. The value of education, the concept of education there is different from here, from what my colleague had just spoken about. People pay their children's way through JAMB, through UTME, through admission and stuff like that.
Special All right? Center.
Forgetting that you cannot go to a particular place and sow banana and you expect to reap orange there. You know, from the very beginning, it's right inside your house. And so he mentioned something that is very important, i.e. that the parents are failing their wards and their children. Because if you yourself, I contested the election in 2007. And when I went to Burial Avenue, they said we should go for certificate verification. When I got there, I put all my certificate from primary 6 to the list. All right, to first degrees and whatever. And the guy who was doing that said, oh, you carry two certificates from the University of Lagos? I said, yes. My master's in literature is from there. My LLB is from there. And said, oh, this is the first time I'm seeing this kind of people coming to contest election. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Perhaps the reason why people, those who introduced me into party politicking, felt the right kind of person they wanted was because they thought by moral suasion I should be able to change the society. But when eventually the parameters, the hook hurdles you have to scale for you to get to that place makes it impossible for you to get there, except when we find ourselves in this kind of forum, when we feel that, oh, this is an opportunity for me to enlighten my people. And of course, people have to be enlightened. The people, the founding fathers of America, if you go through American history, Thomas Paine, you know, go through their history, you will know that people, when Thomas Paine writes essays about nation building, you have to go to school to be able to read that. And even if you have money, even if you have money, and money like in money misrule kind of thing that we have here, oil money, everybody, like he rightly mentioned, 75% of intellectuals in Nigeria are tenants to illiterates. Illiterates are their landlords. That's the reality of our time. Because at a point in time, right, when you are a nail seller, you are a Babatun Taisho, you know, at Olonshogo, you know, you make your money because people want to build houses. And like Dinwalimu says, Julius Nyerere, he said that there is nobody in Africa who is stupendously rich and is so rich legitimately.
Mm-hmm.
The better part of the people who acquire money to be able to have money to buy, build, to build houses, were the people who didn't have to go through the thorough way to get there. And therefore, they have the money to get to the man who is going to sell the name. And so the money goes in the wrong direction. Not in the, at the end of the day, there's a breakdown of law and order. So much so that people, children who otherwise would have been properly tutored and well-trained. A lot of parents themselves who say that they want to send their children to school, ask them to talk. They will tell you that you know that these parents themselves is not properly baked. So as much as possible, and then when the so-called intellectuals come to, like I was at the presidential debate, and you know that woman, that professor woman that contested the presidential election in the last election. When she got there, she said, perhaps there were international audiences here. Let me start my discussion by addressing people in French. She was going. All right? You go to, what's the name of this Liberian president now, the Harvard professor. All right? You get to there. And so when you have a professor like, when you have someone like Barack Obama, Barack Obama was in the Congress. Barack Obama was in the Senate.
Started from the council.
All right. Mm. Barack Obama was a professor of constitutional law in Harvard University. Yeah. So when he gets there, when he gets to constitutional debate, there's going to be quality thinking. So if Nigeria, well, how many are we? We're just about 160 million. All right. Perhaps if we had gone round in destructuring the country into some smaller units, and people can prioritize. All right. The constitution of this country talks about three types of, you know, citizenship. You're either a citizen by birth, or you are by naturalization or by registration. If you're a citizen of Nigeria by birth, it means that any of your parents or either of your parents belongs to a community that is indigenous to Nigeria. And so when Nigerian currency says, right, Yoruba, Igbo, and Hausa, to the exclusion of 247 other languages, all right, we're precipitating crisis because some other people feel that I'm on robo. I'm Isoko, I need to be heard. So these are issues of national development that philosopher kings will think twice and look at, okay, this is what the society needs at this point. People, you go to polytechnic in those days, people now, if you go to it, they'll tell you, yeah, it's ONDs, whatever. People, when we were growing up, all right, when we were growing up, I attended the certificate course admission list at University of Ife, and they brought you to come and do audition for us. And I said, man, if for a certificate course, you had to bring a Nobel, he hadn't won Nobel at that time. If they had to bring a Shoyinka to come and do audition for me, I don't think I would be able to come to this university. So by that time, the halo of intellect was regarded, was seen by everybody. And we didn't get to this level. And there are societies that are still like that. We had cocoa here, we had cocoa in Ghana, we had cocoa in Brazil, all right? And the southwestern part of Nigeria, the better part of the budget of Obafemi Awolowo in developing southwestern part of Nigeria was from cocoa proceeds. Go and look at the structure of Obafemi Awolowo University. The other time when President Obasanjo went to see Bishop Oyedepo, he said that the amount of money the guy used in developing Covenant University, if he had been disbursed to a university, they wouldn't have been able to spend it more than a year, nothing would come out of it.
Not even a friend.
All right? So, at a point in time where, unfortunately, the coup of 1966, whether we like it or not, actually, I don't know how to classify it, because at the end of the day, those prime ministers that were killed at that time, they were still very young. You get to Bauchi and get to the Baliwa Mausoleum.
The guy
had only one transistor radio.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
The Okoti Airbus, well, how much when you buy yards of clothes, so you know, and you say it's flamboyant. You understand what I'm saying? So along the line, we had a lot of political fractures, you know, historical fracture in our, you know, in our life. But you know, maybe we have to go back to the drawing board. If you are saying that you are contesting an election, let us see where you are coming from. All right? If it's a single advocate of Nigeria, like Fashola that they presented, there were yasi by which you want to become a single advocate of Nigeria, i.e. you have been involved in contentious cases and been recorded in Superior Court of Records, you know, at certain number in Federal High Court, at the High Court, certain number at Court of Appeal, so you can measure it. You can measure it. But a situation in which anybody becomes a pastor, he becomes a bishop, he becomes a general overseer, there is no way, there are no parameters by which you define morals there. And people are clustering there. So we find ourselves in this kind of valueless society. I think that's where we have to really look
at. Is the cluster really beclouding us, you know, in even finding solution to this rage that is kidnapping and the gap that is creating between the, you know, older and the younger generation? Do we not see things in the light of the younger generation?
When there are certain characteristics that are inherent in the word younger, youthful, and some of those characteristics are energetic, vibrant, exuberant, those, you know, these are basic characteristics endemic in the world, young, youthful. And when you have such characteristics residual in a particular entity, and that entity is not driven, that is led to purposefulness, those natural characteristics will inevitably take their own vibrancy. But they may take their own vibrancy for negative purposes. Now, let's look at what is happening in our society. We have neighborhoods. It has gotten this bad now. We have neighborhoods where people just live at the mercy of we have perfected the art of rewarding grandstanding and terrorism as an art of living. There is no single I was in a Butemeta on Saturday, and I heard the sound of a gun, and I looked straight into the eyeballs of a youngster. I was born in Mushi, raised in Mushi, so some of these things too I got familiar with growing up. I looked straight into the eyes of a youngster who was in front of me, and he said, Ibonisa, Ibonisa, I'll take care of myself. I was in a living room, well cocooned from the madness outside, but my head was telling me, you know, my car, my vehicle outside was an indication that somebody could be in that neighborhood who could be preyed upon. So my head was telling me I may have to leave without my car. But that was in Ebutemeta, and I was actually told of scenarios such as a youngster or some youngsters who would occasionally come out with bazooka guns in their hand, just shooting in the air. The neighborhood where I was born in Mushi, we thought we were rascally. I was in that neighborhood about 1.5 years ago, and I was literally hushed out. When I got there the following day, because I needed to, you know, get something done, when I got there the following day, they told me that just before my arrival there the other day, that the two courts, were
groups.
Two cults, don't call them groups, cults. That's how bad it's been now. They were fighting, and that one of the boys' head was decapitated, and it was being kicked around like football. This is Lagos. Sometimes you people will sit in Lagos, you'll be speaking big grammar and be talking as though it's only happening in Bayelsa, in Rivers or whatever. Lagos. Look, if you remove, and I tell my wife this very often, if you remove Lekki, if you remove Victoria Island, Ikoyi, Lekki, Oniru, remove it from Lagos, there is no part of Lagos where criminality has not been so endemic in cultism that people literally live at the mercy of charming Sams when the youths of the neighborhood go berserk. And they go berserk ballistically, literally, and ballistically.
Now, where is the law enforcement agency?
Oh, you coming now. Now, if I were to be a policeman, you want me to go and encounter those kids, and there is no life assurance policy for my life, I don't know what becomes of my wife and my children when I'm wasted.
You're serving the fatherland.
You're serving the fatherland. Like those who are above me are serving the fatherland. And the politicians who live larger than life materially without anything to show for it are serving the fatherland. And you know what? It's easy. There is a theory in economics that bad money will always override good money. It's also the same thing about societal morality. If you can see one person who does things negatively getting rewarded, you, who is doing it rightly, can easily be disillusioned except you have higher values. So, and except you have super higher values. Like, say, your belief and conviction in God. If you see a sinner getting rewarded, and you have decided to ascetically keep to the sober and tough lane, my brother, you will be a superwoman being. Not to be easily. And so, and like I said earlier on, we are living in a practical state of anomaly. So you want me to shock you? You think those kids that are parading guns and shooting guns carelessly on the streets, you think they don't have some Babali Bejo that they work for, that is making the police also look the other way? And you think when kidnappings are done in these neighborhoods, you think the police don't know who orchestrated them? We are living in the 21st century, for God's sake, where everybody leaves a digital footstep. My brother, my movement this morning could be tracked from wherever I slept, my house, to where I am now, because I'm carrying a mobile phone. And that mobile phone has a chip. That chip will reveal you anywhere in the world to less than 1 meter from where you are standing. When the case of this guy happened in South Africa, the guy who was convicted for the manslaughter of his girlfriend,
Pistorius.
The South African police authorities, micro detailed his movement within his apartment, not on the street. How he went downstairs, came upstairs, went in one direction in his apartment. And to be honest with you, if we thought that was South Africa, in today's Nigeria, a friend of mine about 4 weeks ago was robbed in his car. The incumbent chief of NRS told him not to worry, that they were going to get the boys. Less than 2 weeks after, that friend was called and told that the two phones that were robbed from him had been tracked electronically to a particular person. Tracked 2 weeks after the phones were stolen. Because these are digital. Weak. Apart from your phone, this has a chip. It could be tracked. So if our police are not quickly getting those who perpetrate kidnappings, go on, Bill.
Gentlemen, okay, that's quite exhaustive, but I know the security agencies are doing their utmost in tracking them. They have trackers and the rest and some other equipment. Yes, the guys are always, criminals who always want to move a step, you know, faster than their pursuers. But let's take a short break, and when we return, we'll be opening our lines to our teaming viewers within and outside the country. Join us again.
Chima, what did they do so?
Same market now, they are collecting.
Yeah. But see when they buy the market, you don't get a receipt. What did they do?
Which receipt? No, we pocket money, they go.
Yeah. You didn't expect tax.
Who be tax?
Me?
Guy, all these SM tax where they run, now tax you.
My brother, make I tell you. Good road, now tax. Security, now tax. To school where your children they go, how you think say them they take pay the teachers? Brother, na tax. And if you not pay your tax, my brother, then go lock your shop.
Abetunde, where did you pay the tax?
Na for tax office now.
Carry me go there.
Who could go? Abu, I post look shop, Abet.
You can now watch Core TV News live from anywhere in the world on our website, www.coretvnews.com. Click on Live TV on our website and watch us live.
And welcome to Core TV Primetime News.
To follow us on Twitter, click on Twitter icon on our website. And Facebook, click on the Facebook. And YouTube to see all our previous news production. You can also watch us live on YouTube. Click Core TV, leave a space, then news. Core TV News, a 24-hour news station.
You're welcome back, and we're on the last lap of Core Digest. That time when we throw our telephone line open for you to be part of the program. And the topic, so far, so wonderful, the kidnapping rage, a generational issue. But I'm still here with the lawyer, the businessman, and the friend of the house has had to quickly, you know, run away, not because of anything untoward. The number to call if you want to be part of this program is 081-816-481-8001. And that number is right on your screen. 081-816-481-8001. That's the number to call. Barrister Magneza, let me come back to you. You know, all these worrisome pictures, like even the one Bola Oba painted, the youths now on the street in an area forming a cult group and with sophisticated weapons. You know, it looks so bleak that, hey, we're going to be, you know, with kidnapping for a long time to come. It's one of, you know, the battles of the Nigerian society that everybody seems to be paying for.
Well, definitely, sure. That is that's a price we have to pay for a lot of things, a lot of misdemeanor, a lot of misbehavior, misconduct of the past. But the present has to interrogate the past anyway to be able to determine what the future is going to be like. Human beings are supposed to have hope. They're not supposed to despair. And when we are here on television or through the media, we are not supposed to give the idea of everything is collapsed and the world is coming to an end. It should be our responsibility to ensure that we socialize ourselves to the fact that there is still hope, that we still can retrace our steps to where we started from. One of which is that, for instance, in the Nigerian body polity, if we restructure the system, we go back, we get into regional administration, people can prioritize, they can determine what are their priorities on the basis of their geography, on the basis of their culture, on the basis of their values.
The environment and the rest.
And then so much so that emphasis, you know, are placed on some areas of our national life that have been neglected. You know, time was when somebody was saying that, I think it was President Obasanjo, I can't be too sure of quoting him, that, you know, he said there was no need teaching history in the Nigerian curriculum. And when Professor Tekken Tamuno, former Vice Chancellor, University of Ibadan, came for the award of the Nigerian Academy of Letters at the University of Lagos, and I asked him, you know, because he acknowledged President Obasanjo's, you know, President Obasanjo acknowledged him in my command.
Yeah.
And then he said that, the university didn't, it's not like surrogate writing that you have today. Mm. You know, if you are a writer today, you are a writer, but you have a lot of hagiographers who write as a surrogate to somebody. Somebody claims to be an author of a book. You cannot even read or write a sentence before you know it, because, you know, those are the values that has gone to the dogs. Mm. You understand? I remember when Chief Tom McKinney said that, when Soyinka was, Ante Abacha, and he was out of the country, and Tom McKinney said, what is the big deal about somebody winning the Nobel Prize? You know, anybody can win the Nobel.
Oh, well, that's how Bayes is on thinking. Right? That's an architect
when you say things like that, when you say things like that, it goes a long way to degrade moral values in the society. And I think that we have to be very careful. Those of us who are here in the media, who have had to be on the editorial board of newspaper, we have to do an editorial. Yeah, you project issues as they ought to be.
Okay, let me just put you on pause there, because we've got our first caller, Innocent from Edo State. Good morning, Innocent.
Hello,
good morning, Innocent. Can you speak a little louder, please, for us to hear you?
Thank you.
Can you hear me?
Hello?
Well, Innocent, you're not talking loud enough for us to hear you.
Hello?
Yeah, go on. I can hear you now. Can you please go on?
Hello?
Okay, well, Innocent is just saying hello there, you know. Yeah, I said we can hear you. I'm sure you're watching. You can see my gesture. Can't you?
Hello?
Magnesia, yes. I think we're having problems with that. So, what kind of solution should we really be looking at now?
We have to go back to the drawing board. There are a lot of things that have gone wrong in our society. You want to talk about rural urban migration? You want to talk about the obliteration of the village communal life? That is no longer in our system. Everybody's unto himself. It's a Leviathan state, according to Thomas Hobbes, where life is short, nasty, and brutish.
Yeah.
Everybody's unto himself. God is for us all. So we have to go back to some core values. And that is why I said that if I were to find myself in the National Conference or National Conference or the National Assembly, I actually contested, because I thought that lawmaking was the in thing for me. Make some laws that could be, you know, followed. Where we could evolve ideas and values. And I think that we have to go back to the cultural values, all right? If an average Nigerian, you know, should have read Things Fall Apart, for instance, you know, The Experience of Okonkwo, whatever. And I think we have a magnum opus like that, a classic like that, could be translated into 250 languages.
It's translated into more than 70 languages in the world.
You have it.
But it's just only in English. Yeah. I've never seen a Things Fall Apart in Igbo literature.
It's only in Yoruba. Wale Ogunyemi.
Yeah.
All right. And when we have things like that, Soyinka's the trust of Brother Jero.
Yeah.
All right. Made into a film, made compulsory. If you say you want to found a church, it is compulsory text for you to have read, so that you know that when you'll be able to draw a line between when you are a charlatan and when you are not. You'll be able to draw a line between when you are into business or when you are into religion.
Yeah.
All right? And so you talk about health, societal health from there. This is where my thesis, you know, is trying to propose an interface between literature and medicine, because people are not healthy mentally. The society is not healthy. When people come together, they say they are forming rival cults and they are decapitating heads and they are kicking like football. That's a base level of our humanity.
It is really base. All okay. Right. Sorry. We have Umba is calling from Niger State. Good morning, Umba. Welcome to Core Digest. Hello, Umba. Can you hear me?
Yeah, good morning.
Yeah, good morning. Yes, join in the debate. We are looking at...
Yeah, I can hear you. I say good morning.
I've answered you back. I said good morning to and welcome.
Are you still... Thank you very much. Okay. Please, what I'm suggesting in terms of the...
Please go on.
In terms of what you are discussing over there. Yeah.
Go on.
We have to make sure that people that are in the system.
I don't know why. I think this thing is intermittent, so it's really difficult.
If you are being employed or you want to get to a certain office, you have to.
Oh, sorry. We're really not getting the. Sorry, Umba. We're not really getting the drift of your contribution here, so it will be difficult, respond to whatever you're saying. We're really sorry for that. We hope we get the telephony system right. You were talking about such a morose situation, like the beheading, the court rivalry, and the rest. The state does not seem to have really put in adequate laws for punishment of kidnapping. Most of what we see, particularly in the southeast, Anambra, for example, is the governor, known kidnaps, that kidnapper, they destroy the houses and the rest. But I thought the state is, Delta State is supposed to have passed, the death penalty for kidnappers. Is it going to work?
Well, that's why we want to look at when you talk about sociology and criminology.
Mm.
All right? What is the object of criminology? What is the object of studying criminology? And then you branch out into looking at penology. You look at victimology. Who are the victims? What kind of penalty do you give to them? How is the society saner in the pursuit of that objective? Those objectives. So those are the areas we want to look at. If you issue out death penalty, capital punishment, to people who indulge in this kind of thing, has it reduced it? When the military came, when during the oil boom, we first of all had armed robbers, in the 70s, when there was spate of arms going out, began to have highway robbers, all right? And Nigeria subscribed to capital punishment as a municipal law. Mm. I.e. that people are taken to Bar Beach, they are shot dead.
Mm.
The question is that, has it reduced highway robbery? Has it been a deterrent to robbery? Answer is no.
Okay, answer is no.
Yes.
Let's take Shegun. Shegun is calling from Kogi State. Good morning, Shegun. Hello, Shegun, good morning. I think there is a delayed response here.
Yes.
Yeah, you say the answer.
Good morning.
Yeah, good morning, Shegun. Yeah. So, tell us, what are your thoughts about the kidnapping rage that is on in Nigeria now?
Please, I cannot hear you.
Well, I'm hearing you very loud and clear. I don't know why you're not hearing me. Sorry. Makneza, when we talk about crime and punishment,
yes,
have they really helped in reforming society? Has it helped in correcting some of these tendencies? Because this one is a rage of just a decade ago, but it's still snowballing. It's not simmering down at all.
That's why in contemporary scientific knowledge, you talk more about preventive medicine than curative medicine. when the society feels that the only way to cure a crime is to
enact draconian
is to be after the event
draconian in its solution.
Even if you are draconian, do you take measures to make sure it doesn't happen? For instance, as at the time you were calling me this morning, I was stuck in traffic. All right, and anything could happen. Mm. That could be a snap. All right, somebody could walk on my nerves, and I just felt that I have an appointment and I can't get there on time.
Mm.
Are you with me? The level of insanity is high. Level of insanity. The society,
it's unbelievable.
You can't be sane.
Mm.
All right, and if you think that pursuing values and virtue, and then something happened, a last man guy came to apprehend.
The vehicle,
all right, and because the vehicle I was in passed through BRT lane, and then he came to accost our driver.
But that was wrong.
That's why we are talking about the morality behind law itself.
Yeah.
When does the law become enforceable?
Mm.
The philosophy of law is lex non cogit ad impossibilia.
Okay.
The law cannot command the impossible.
Mm.
If a society has made room, adequate room for a breakdown of law and order, it's going to reap in harvest. So if you are not coming to say that you want to prevent it, the question is that have you tried to address the cause? So that guys who are supposed to be street urchins, who grow up on the streets without care, teachers who go to class, manipulating a lot of things, students who get admission without the requirements, without having studied for it, all right? I was a teacher in secondary school before I went to do my undergraduate. I was already with school start and teachers before. I was a teacher in secondary school. I was teaching literature, language, English language, and fine arts before I went to study language and literature. So, meaning that at that time, school certificates was very valuable. You were employable.
Mm.
You were employed as school certificate as teachers. You were earning 75 naira. If you don't have your complete papers, if you had your complete paper, you have 96.
They call it S75.
If you had your teacher's grade 2, you want 120 naira.
Those were the days.
All right. And I remember I bought a motorcycle. My first motorcycle that I bought under 100, under a Suzuki 100, was for 300 naira.
So Okada has been here with us for a long time.
It was 300 naira. As a teacher, I would take it to where I want to read.
You must have saved for about 6 months to get that.
Yeah. You just somebody. I think my sister gave me some money to give to my mother, and then I just felt that okay, 200 naira. I add this one to it. I could buy a motorbike. And the next thing I saw, the woman. I said, "What did you do with the money?" I said, "This is what I bought with it." So okay, that's all right. Now what you are saying is that a society where the time was when Nigeria was saner. As a teacher in primary school, you want to go and teach in primary school. You have to prepare your lesson notes. The value starts from there.
Mm.
What do you want to teach? You have to sign the lesson. The headmaster has to sign the lesson before you go to class and begin to teach that.
Mm.
And then when you find out that students that were when my first son was in primary school, he was always going to class with Reader's Digest. Teachers were borrowing Reader's Digest from him. And as at the time he was in primary 3, primary 4, he had read almost all those guys that won the Nobel later, like Paul, a couple of them.
Mm.
He would have read them. You understand what I'm saying? Because of the background where he was coming from. And so when you go take that into the classroom environment, you find out that the child itself finds an environment in which you have to be reading, because it's all me reading. You have to. There's something you are doing. This and the other reading now.
Yeah.
All right. Now, so at the end of the day, you find out that the society can take its bearing from there. And then all of a sudden, when you run into some brother Jeroboam, some prophet Jeroboam, I'll give you all kind of orientation, give you all kind of visions. I was talking to somebody, I said, "Where are you from?" He said, "It's from Osun State." Mm-hmm. I said, "Why are you building a house in Ikorodu?" He said, "Because going back to town, but go to the village, there are enemies there." I said, "But you were born inside the enemies. They didn't kill you." All right? So time was when values were values. Are you with me? To the extent that at a point in time, Dr. Fasi, my elder brother, the first Nigerian to do a PhD in acupuncture, first African, to do a PhD in acupuncture, and the first one of the he went to some of the oldest universities in the world, University of Aberdeen, the oldest medical college in the world.
Mm-hmm.
You find some of those guys becoming prisoners. Who want to be like that, right? But guys who were in military, were in uniform, who could get appointments, they were private, living in some of the choicest parts of the society. That's where we're here.
The breakdown
so
begins.
So, at the end of the day, when a charlatan politician who didn't know anything, who couldn't speak any English, and insofar as he can give money to students in the campuses, and You know, and they go and recruit them. You can imagine professor, I can remember a professor at the University of Ife, students carrying a vice chancellor. You can imagine at the University of Lagos, at Lagos University happened. They assaulted Professor Mrs. Jadisola Akande, students. Students will be throwing sachets of water to vice chancellors. So this value has gone really, really
it's
down.
It's really broken. All right? It's really broken.
So that the guy who comes.
The 1 year I spent doing my master's in English department at University of Lagos, I never saw my vice chancellor for what?
You understand what I'm saying?
What are you seeing him for?
And where you want to go, where you go, where you read a book, where you mention, what's the name of our vice president? Yemi Oshibaju.
Yeah.
When you read, I know it's lost today. The first thing that comes to your cases and materials on law of evidence.
Okay.
You know where it's coming from.
Let me put you on pause there. Victor from Benue State. I hope we get this really right now. Good morning, Victor.
Hello?
Yeah, good morning, Victor. We are with you on Call Digest. We can hear you, Victor. Yes. Look at me nerd in my head. I'm nodding my head, yes.
My advice for my country is that the government should have the means of increasing job opportunities to the youth. That is one of the leading aspects of the second part. Because many graduates have been out of university, free to service, and they still have been a free job. An idle man is an endemic worker. So they should get an employment and encourage them so that they should have something new. And the other one is that they should also find a way of empowering the youth, if not giving them the job, so that they do some money. Like some people are studying on their personal development, like the technical aspect of it. If there is money, they can invent something that will still be doing instead of paying to buy the future.
Okay, thank you very much. That's Victor. Victor is hinging this malady, this breakdown in, you know, the entire fabrics of the society, the issue of kidnapping, to lack of engagement of the youths, lack of employment. But this government is talking about, you know, retooling the skills of, you know, the Nigerian youth. We're talking of skills acquisition now and the rest. Do you think it's a panacea to redress it?
You remember that when I was going to make my contribution to the book launch of Professor Iraga,
yeah.
I started from Aristotle.
Absolutely, you did.
Aristotle says that tragedy is an imitation of action that is serious, that is complete, that is of certain magnitude. In language, embellished with different kinds of artistic ornaments, the different kinds being found in various parts of the play. In form of action, not narrative, through pity and fear, affecting the proper purgation of those emotions. Now, the society that is... man is naturally mimetic. Man is naturally imitative. When you see somebody like the last speaker here said, you see somebody that is going the wrong way and is prosperous, the society is rewarding it. And the society, somebody that is in the library, is hooked to the library, is reading 24 hours. The society doesn't say that. All right? Even in the way he's gone into footballing, he's brought fame to Nigeria, is an artifact of international relations for you to win sports and whatever. However, there are people who want to be thorough with academic. A medical doctor, I know a Nigerian medical doctor that went to the University of Bokoni. And when he got there, he was the last to get there. And when he got there, he scored 105 out of 110, 96% of the exam. And when the Senate met, the Senate found out that they cannot give this person 96%. They have to give him 110 out of 110. A Nigerian here, trained here in this country, given the thorough way he was brought up.
Yeah.
And you can't be half measure. If you are a half measure, you are a non-entity. All right? So these are issues that we have to go back into. All right? Professor, people who angle around themselves, even getting promotion in the universities, all right? Even getting promotion anywhere, getting notice, you understand what I'm saying? How many sources are, even in the media practice, what are our focus? How much attention do we give to a professor of soil science, for instance? who want to talk about what happens to a parcel of land when the land is abused. A professor of geology who has something to tell us about the nature of our planet. How much of that are we doing? In those days, you have Shehu Ogun Sheyitan, the science correspondent in the Guardian. I mean, what?
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? Because these are the society, and so you hold those ones as role models. But today, the kind of celebrities who celebrate on the pages of newspapers are
from Nollywood
stars, nudity, you know, whatever. Yeah. So we have to start from there, from redefining our value system from our home as a father. How was of that to you? Was that very, very clear? Did your dad ever try? I'm not sure any one of us that our father helped us to get admission. No, you have to read for it.
Never.
You understand what I'm saying? And then since after Shoyinka has won the Nobel, we were looking at the Oshofi sons and whatever. Who are the other people that we are looking at, you know, that have been contributing to knowledge? The other time, Professor Mrs. Akachizeke was retiring, you know, from the University of Lagos. Some of those ones, you look at them, okay, yeah, it's a professor, yeah, it's an author. And so, where is the, you know, the society we see was in those days, when you look at people like that, you understand what I'm saying? You see people like that, and you know that this is an academic. You understand what I'm saying? You respect an academic. Today, anyone we talk to a professor, say, "Professor, get out of the room." So these are the issues.
Well, thank you very much, Barrister Makneza Faseun. My journalist brother is left now to go and wear the, is it the wig or the silk that you wear?
The wig and the gown.
Yeah. And thanks so very much for being part of this program. I believe very strongly that the viewers at home, particularly those who tried to call onto this program, unfortunately we had the little gap in the telephony system. But we hope we've been able, you know, to look at all the ramifications of the kidnapping rage, a generational issue, and we looked at how to redress it and how to get society back, you know, to its roots of yesteryear. Yes, reconciling it with the modernities of today, but in making projections into the future, it won't be for the wrong cause or the wrong causes. Thanks very much for being part of our program today, Core Digest. And by tomorrow, my colleague will be seeing you on Core Digest Extra. It's a little toned down, where in some cases you come and, you know, display your entrepreneurial skills, you know, for others to learn and the rest, so that we can make Nigeria a better society. That's what we're wished for. Thanks for watching. My name is Christian Ogodo. Bye-bye.
You can now watch Core TV News live from anywhere in the world on our website, www.coretvnews.com. Click on Live TV on our website and watch us live.
And welcome to Core TV Primetime News.
To follow us on Twitter, click on Twitter icon on our website. And Facebook, click on the Facebook and YouTube to see all our previous news production. You can also watch us live on YouTube. Click Core TV, leave a space, then news. Core TV News, a 24-hour news station.